We can stop the rain. Welcome to Decent Life. I'm Lou Pugliafito. The call-in number is 212-245-7273. 212-245-7273. The guidelines for calling in are is to lower the volume on your TV or computer while you're calling in, because we don't want any feedback. Also, listen to your phone and not the computer or the TV, because we are on an 8-second delay. So I'll be trying to talk to you and you'll be listening to the TV and I'll be hanging up before you know it. And also, no profanity, please. And if you like, you could give us your first name and location where you're calling from. On Saturday, April 25th, is National Parental Alienation Awareness Day. And to talk about parental alienation and his organization is Christopher Howard. Welcome,
good.
Chris.
Thank you. It's good to be here again.
Yeah, you're welcome. It's great to have you again. It's been about a year from,
maybe a year.
Yeah, because I think you were on prior to the same subject last year.
Which
is parental alienation. And I think a great place to start is to, if you give us a brief description of parental alienation.
Sure. Well, it's kind of a tough one. It runs a broad range, but basically, when a couple splits and they have a child and one tries to poison the child against the other, they're alienating the other parent. That can be done in many, many different ways. It can be subtle. It can be outright. It can be psychological. There's all kinds of ways that it can happen. And it's really been deemed a form of child abuse. It really is. So, you know, one of the things that we do in our organization is try to bring awareness to the situation.
So basically, there's an old, I think, cliche that says, I'm not going to end it at a spouse. I'm just going to put spouse instead of what it used to be before. One spouse uses the child as a weapon against the other,
yeah, absolutely. Per se. Absolutely.
And the courts, how do the courts fuel this?
In my experience, the courts can fuel this. And do, and often do. Judges are people. They can be biased. You can go into a courtroom situation, and they can decide they don't like one of the parents, and they can condone this behavior, or they can just turn away and not deal with it. So I think the courts play a pretty big role in alienation, and you know, of course, it's called a family court. But that doesn't mean anything, because I think the family court system is instrumental in destroying families.
Okay, so most people from her, there is a problem. It's not to say that all judges are like this in the system, but basically the system itself requires change. And the organization that you work for, National Parents Organization, can you fill us in what this organization is trying to do?
Sure. Sure. We are basically a lobbying organization. We don't give legal help or advice, but what we do, we have people who are advocating for court reform. We have lobbyists up in Albany. We have people who are trying to get bills passed. We have people who are trying to write new legislation and get it into the mix. There have been bills in the Senate and the Assembly in New York for years that keep getting squashed. So, you know, we have people who go up to Albany regularly to visit with senators and other lawmakers and try to bring awareness to the fact that these bills just aren't getting through. And we need people on board. We need the lawmakers on board to get these bills passed.
So do you think that, I'm not sure how to express it, is that all these deadbeat fathers have made the judges and the system bias?
Well,
per se, I'm just.
Well, you've used the cliche that in this, we're going to talk about this New York Times article at some point, but actually in our blog on our website that refers to this article, that the term deadbeat dad, it's not real. It's something that was made up years and years ago. And it's fictional. You know, sure, there are people who don't pay their child support. There are women who don't pay their child support, too. This is not just about men. There's both genders involved here.
Which is good about your organization, because it's not a father's organization or mother's organization. It's a parent's
organization. Right, it's a parent's organization. We're completely gender neutral. And we have to be, especially since, you know, things have changed. We have same-sex marriage, so when there's a divorce in a same-sex marriage, you can't have gender bias. You have two women splitting, you have two men splitting, and there are often children involved. So that's a whole different game.
Exactly.
You know, so it's not a deadbeat anybody.
And even, I mean, things are so skewed now because you have lady from show, what is it, Middle Family, whatever it is. I don't watch it.
Oh, Modern Family?
Modern Family.
Yeah, I don't really watch that much, but I know what you're talking
about.
And
she's having a fight with her ex over the embryos that are frozen.
Right.
So there's a lot of things involved in parenthood, and it seems how it's better to approach this genderless because there's so many different ways. So many different types of family situations now.
There are, and I think the reality, and our organization is really a children's advocacy group, because the people that get lost in this are the children. They become weapons. They become pawns in a game between the parents, and that's just wrong. I mean, we're hurting the children by doing this. And people are when they're splitting up, they're selfish. They're thinking about themselves. They're thinking about what they want. And they're thinking about winning, and there is no winning. There's no winning. When you're harming your own child, there's no win. Nobody wins.
Right, because I think if you ask any child what they want is both their parents.
Of course. Of course they do.
You know, and if they cannot live together, then living separately, they still want equal access, open access to both parents.
Yeah, and, you know, it can happen, and it does happen. I know people who have managed to split up and gone to mediation and avoided the court system, and they have perfectly amicable arrangements where they both see their child or children. It can be done. Staying out of the court system is helpful in that regard, because the court system fuels animosity. They like a war. The court system likes a war. The lawyers like a war because it's a moneymaker. It's a moneymaker for everybody. If they can keep you in court, lawyers make out, everybody wins. The state gets money out of it. I mean, it's a big money-making operation.
Yeah.
You know, and again, the child gets lost in all of this.
And it's also a good way for one parent to use the system against the other parent.
Sure. The system is abused all of the time.
Because what actually, see, I'm not sure now, this, like in New York State, is that it's automatic that the child is with the mother, and the father has to fight to get more time.
I don't know if that's necessarily automatic, but it's certainly, I think, if I'm not mistaken, about 80% of the time the child winds up with the mother.
Okay.
You could say, yeah, pretty much. So it's not. Nobody's legally bound to do that, but that's the way it works out.
So do you think that if the law up front, like when you're lobbying to say, you know what, when you're coming into divorce court, the assumption we're going to make is 50-50 each parent, unless proven otherwise, instead of one parent having all the time and the other parent trying to prove.
Right, yeah.
I think it removes a lot of the leverage.
Our organization advocates for presumed shared parenting when it makes sense. I mean, there are relationships where there are crazy people, there are drug addicts, there are all kinds of things. There are other factors, but generally, if both parents are fit, there's no reason why you shouldn't have a 50-50 shared parenting.
And you really shouldn't be even in the court system, because two normal people who are adults, and yes, you might not like each other anymore, if you might not want the other spouse did to you, but when it comes to the child, you bury the hatchet and you do what's best.
That's ideal, but we're people. I'm we're just people, saying, yeah. You know, that would be great if people could do that. But, you know, I think that by the time you get into a situation where you're getting divorced or you're in court, You've been fighting. You've probably been fighting in front of your children. They've probably seen it.
Right.
You know, so they're already in the middle of it. You know, they've heard it, they've seen it. No, nobody, you know, tells, I don't know, maybe they do, tell their kid to go to the next room while they go into battle, you know.
But you still can hear it.
It's not practical.
Right, so basically, for what you're saying, even for the good of the children, a split is probably the best thing. Because if you guys are always fighting, it's not good for the child to see this violence in the house.
Of course. You know, that's the intelligent thing to do.
Yeah. Because a lot of people say, oh, no, you're going to stay together for the children.
Right.
But it more and more becomes a fallacy.
Of course.
Because the child is seeing violence in the house because both parents are always younger than the children.
Wouldn't you rather have your child live a peaceful existence?
Right.
Isn't that better? I think that's better for everybody.
Exactly.
We're talking about a lot of ideals here that we hope, you know, people can come to terms with. But, you know, that's what we're after.
And what was interesting is that that you wanted to talk about the incident that happened with the gentleman that got shot,
right?
And the child support thing, and I thought you wanted to touch upon on that article.
I do actually, and our website has a blog post about this as well. This was in the New York Times on Monday of this week. About probably lots of people have heard about this gentleman, and I think it's South Carolina. I'm looking at it, but who was shot in the back running from a traffic stop. And it turns out that he had, had some difficulties with child support and had been jailed on numerous occasions for back child support. I can't get into what, you know, I don't know this person. I don't know what went on exactly, but I can say that I know personally that this goes on in the court system where people are ordered to pay much more than they can possibly afford. They're jailed, all kinds of things go on. Now, what this does is it gives the other parent the opportunity to alienate that person, because if you miss a child support payment, suddenly the other parent is saying, look at what a bad person that is. You know, he didn't make his child support payment, so he's a bad person. So you shouldn't spend any time with him or her. I'm saying him because this is a man that this happened to.
And isn't it at one point you were saying that the judge ordered you to pay 150% of your income?
I have been in a situation where I've had a child support order directing me to pay at 115% of my income. 85% was taken out of my paycheck, and I went into arrears, even though they were taking 85% of my pay, because I couldn't pay the other, 25-30%. On top of the 85%, because I was only getting 15%. And I'm still in arrears because of that. And in fact, I had never missed a child support payment.
And you were threatened to go into jail as well?
I was, and it gave my ex-wife's attorney the opportunity to try to have me incarcerated for the arrears that accumulated because of a bogus child support order.
And during that time, she was withholding access to the children, or were you still able to?
Well, the problem with access to the children is, A, I couldn't afford to see them because I couldn't get anywhere.
Because
of the child support arrears, the first part of which only accumulated because when I lost my job a few years ago, her attorney postponed the hearing for 9 months. So during that 9 months, enough arrears accumulated for the support collection unit to take my driver's license. That was the first thing they did.
Do you have your driver's license now?
No.
You still
don't
have
it? No, it'll be years before I get it back. It'll be years.
So let's say if you had to drive somewhere for a job.
I can't. I can't get behind the wheel of a car. And until it's paid in full, and it's gone up and down because there were times when I got a modified order. Support collection unit decided they didn't want to honor it because they have that. They can do that.
Okay.
If they don't like it, they cannot honor it. There's all kinds of things that go
on. So what do we think the lawmakers should do about this child support system? Is it really promoting and helping the parent that pays the child support? Is it helping to fuel them to continue to work and not be on the run or whatever it is, and be in jail? Is there a way to...
The support collection system is set up, it doesn't benefit anyone at this point. I think that if you read this article, you'll see that it was set up in the 90s, and it was aimed towards wealthy people who actually could afford to pay child support and were ducking it. not for people who actually couldn't pay. So the ones that are suffering are the ones who actually can't pay, who have these orders that are just outrageous and can't pay them, and they're the ones who are going to jail, not the ones who can afford to duck it and get a good lawyer and skip out. I mean, that's just, it's just crazy the way it's set up.
Right. So,
and they take everything from you. You know, they just keep taking things. You know, I've lost my driver's license, my passport, and my bank accounts. You know, it's just what they do. It's just what they do. Without regard for whether you can see your child, they don't care about the kids.
The system.
The child support unit, collection unit, couldn't care less.
Okay,
about your collection.
Children.
Yeah. They don't care.
They just have a job. Hey, you didn't pay. Come on, let's go.
Plus, in New York State, the person who's getting the support is not accountable for the money. So they don't have to use it for the children. If you're paying support, they can do anything they want. There is absolutely no accountability.
So you're saying that, hey, you know, I'll pay the child support, but let's have some type of audit or accountability to where the money goes?
There are states where you have to be accountable for at least a percentage of the support that you collect. It has to go towards certain expenses of your child, you know?
So the expenses for child support is it like the home and what specifically does child support cover?
It's the percentage of, you know, putting a roof over their head, you know, your electricity, food, you know, real basic necessities. You know, there's also a push to try to assess, rather than just taking a percentage of one's income, but to assess what the actual cost of raising that child is and use that as the benchmark rather than, you know, you make such and such an amount, we're just going to take this percentage of it. Has nothing to do with what it costs to raise a child.
Right.
And nobody cares what it costs to raise a child. Studies have been done, how much it costs. There are people who are working on this.
Yeah.
But got a very long way to go.
It doesn't matter. The main thing is, how do you keep the person paying child support able to work?
Yeah,
And not to put them in jail, so you have this cycle of, you know, you skip a payment, you go to jail, and you lose your job.
Yeah, well, this is what happened. This gentleman missed a payment. They put him in jail. He lost his job. So that begins the cycle, you know, and once you're in jail, the arrears don't stop adding up because you're in jail. They just keep accruing more. You can't pay because you're in jail. How are you going to pay because you're in jail? How does that work? How does that benefit anyone?
Well, so there is an article, because I know that you guys are lobbying, right? You want to lobby
we are lobbying
the government.
Yeah.
And You did the NPO did a survey?
We did a nationwide, well, it wasn't a survey, it was actually a study on the various...
court systems?
It was the support laws. I think it was the child support laws throughout the country.
Okay, so let me just bring it up, because I thought it was interesting.
New York got an F, I believe.
Yeah, New York...
We have some of the worst child support laws in the country.
And just going down is that it's stating here that zero states received an A, only 8 states got Bs, and 18 states got Cs, but 25 states, D or an F. And the two F states were New York and, what was the other one? And Connecticut? No, Rhode Island was that. So how did the study come about? Did you do, the research that you did?
This was done up in Massachusetts by the National Board, so I didn't personally get involved.
Oh, you mean
the
NPO Board?
The NPO National Board hired some people to actually go through each state's
laws?
The laws of each state to see which ones were the best and which ones were failures.
So who basically had a baseline of what would be, I'm just scrolling down to New York State right now. And we have New York. And there's two columns here. One says positives and one says negatives.
Yeah, we haven't got any positives. There you go. There you go, right there.
All right. So if you have your work cut out for you in this state. But what you're saying is no explicit statutory recognition of shared parenting or joint legal custody.
There isn't.
Priority?
That's the top priority, is presumed shared parenting. We have to start there, because right now in our state we have presumed sole custody. It's not even sole custody, it's now I'm losing it now. Because you can get joint custody But that doesn't mean you're going to have shared parenting. They're two very different things.
Okay, so...
That's something a lot of people don't understand.
Okay, so what would be the difference between joint custody and shared parenting?
Well, joint custody just means you each have equal custody of the child. That doesn't mean they live with both parents equally. They can still be 90% of the time with one parent. You know, I've had joint custody. No one's ever questioned custody in my case, but the kids have never lived with me.
Okay, so but to make decisions like on health care, in theory,
you know, that whoever they're living with is supposed to contact and consult the non-custodial parent, but that doesn't happen.
Okay, so shared parenting means that the actual physical time of the child is shared.
The physical time is shared, and what you just talked about, you know, decisions that are made are discussed between the two parents. That's shared parenting.
And I'm not sure if I can find it on your website, but there was another survey done about, not by the NPO, but about what the statistics are of families that do not have, that went through divorce and shared, and they don't have shared parenting?
Yes, there have been studies done, and I can't recite actual numbers, but I think, you know, a high percentage of children who live with a single parent, you know, you get into drug addiction, drug abuse, suicide, teenage pregnancies, all those things escalate when the shared parenting doesn't happen. There might be on there. You might find that statistic on there somewhere. I'm not quite exactly sure where it is.
Right. So basically, it's coming out to say is that, hey, we've been doing this all wrong. All right, we need to adjust the system here. Yeah. You know, the children need both parents, and if not, look what happens: look at the drug abuse, the unwed mothers, and so on.
I think what we really need to do is change our culture. We need to change the attitude of people, because the laws are great, and we can get bills passed, but unless, you know, the people change their attitude towards this, nothing's going to change. It's not going to matter, because, frankly, the judges in family court do not have to obey the laws. Family court is a closed door. People can do anything they want in there.
But if you set a minimum, if a law came in, they can't go,
can't enforce the law. They can't do it. You can't. There's nobody policing. There's nobody policing it. There's no way to enforce
it. Well, let me give you an example. Like in New York State, I think you said it, if you have one child, it's 17%.
Right.
But the judge can't go below that, but the judge could.
They can go as high as they want to.
Right. So isn't there like, can there be a standard and say, you know, it has to be 50-50 and the judge can't get around that until proven that the other parent is. Not fit?
You can. You can, and it will take, you know, years and years to enforce it. And you also have to understand, too, that if a family court judge makes a decision, let's say you don't have the money for a lawyer, you can't appeal it, because then you have to go to another court to do that. You know, there's a lot of layers in this. There's a lot involved. Yeah. So it's a tough road. It's a tough road, especially for people who don't have money.
And exactly. It seems that people who are tied up in all these laws are the people who don't have money, where the laws were made for people who could afford it.
And these are the people who are going to jail, or the people who are poor.
And do you have opposition to these changes?
Of course we do. Of course we do. Helene Weinstein up in Albany, she's been squashing these bills for years.
And what reason? Who is she?
She is, you got me on the spot here. She's a very high-level politician from the city here, actually out in Brooklyn. She doesn't want to have anything to do with shared parenting. And she calls the shots up in Albany.
Okay.
So if it doesn't get past her, it doesn't get past.
So does it assume that she's being unreasonable and that other people just
Of course, but, you know, she's been in the Senate for, I don't know how many years, 20, 30 years.
Okay, so basically old values die hard with her.
Absolutely.
And so you're at the mercy of people. Because I also thought the opposition is saying, you know, these organizations just want to cut down the child support we get or the alimony we get.
Yeah, well,
some organizations say that as well.
This again goes back to the whole cultural shift, because if we get enough people behind this, these politicians will follow. They're not going to have a choice. Right. You know, if we start getting thousands and thousands of people behind us, you know, the laws will then follow. Things will change.
Okay.
You know, you don't ever get the laws first. I think if you look through history, you'll find that, you know, the social change happened before the laws changed.
So basically, it's just like with same-sex marriages. It's society changed, accepting it prior to the laws being
absolutely
being
that's
changed.
That's the way it works every single time.
Okay. So we have a nice picture of you on your website here. I'm not sure everybody sees
great.
It. So
great.
If they would like to contact you, or like to join, like to... help the NPO.
You can join us through the website. You can sign on in New York or any other state for that matter. You can contact me directly through my email address.
And it's Christopher Howard at nationalparentsorganization.org.
And I promise you I respond to every email I get. So please get in touch. We need members. We need people to get behind this.
All right, and we're about wrapping up. Is there one thought that you'd like to...
Wow, this went by quickly, didn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, you know, you're welcome to come back, because I know there's a lot to talk about here.
Is there anything
going on for April 25th? Is there anything coming up?
There's probably a lot of things going on. I don't know off the top of my head what events are going on, but there's usually... Take a look online.
Okay.
There's an organization, april25th.org. that you can look up online and see what's going on.
Okay, April 25th.org.
Our friend Joe Barrow, I think, out of California, started that organization. So he's traveled the country in a van trying to bring awareness of parental alienation to the public.
And what the good news is, you will have a show coming on MNN, on the MNN Network.
And NPO of New York. We're working on our own broadcast right now over the next couple of months. And so keep your eye open. We'll be advertising it on our website.
Well, Chris,
when we're ready.
It was good to have you. I appreciate you coming in.
Great to be
talking about this.
Thanks.
And we can stop the rain, and all you need is love. Good night, everybody.